Welcome to the Daily Faceoff Show, your everyday source for the latest news with top-notch insight and analysis. Live every weekday at noon Eastern.
It is a February 3rd edition of the Daily Faceoff Show, and holy smokes, we're seeing each other in person right now.
This is real. It's happening.
We are coming to you live from beautiful Las Vegas, Nevada for the NHL All-Star Weekend. Tyler Remchuk, Scott Burnside, Mike McKenna with you. We got 30 minutes of straight hockey talk loaded up, so let's throw 2 minutes and 30 seconds up on. And let's just start with this, guys. The fact that we're here, the fact that the NHL is able to put on this event again, the fact that they're doing it in Las Vegas, and it's on this grand scale. Scott, I'll start with you. What does it mean to be back at an All-Star Weekend?
Yeah, well, first of all, I perhaps need a box for our next show. I didn't realize you guys were going to be so tall. Thank you very much for doing that. But and actually, you know, I think when being here in Las Vegas, and I think being here, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago and doing a story about the possibilities of an NHL team here in Vegas and what would it look like and would people support it and how would it fit in the NHL landscape? Well, we know the answer to that. It fits marvelously. It's one of the, you know, I think the standard bearers in terms of organizations in the NHL in a very short period of time. But for me, it's about, you know, maybe a glimpse into what normal looks like and the fact that players are coming here and the media and the sponsors and fans, you see them all over the place here in Las Vegas, even in the last couple of days with their jerseys on. And maybe I'm Pollyannish, but to me, this speaks to maybe what we can look forward to down the road, getting back to normal and getting through the pandemic and having, you know, things back to normal. And it's great to see you guys. And it's great to be at an NHL event live and in person.
It is. And I think about just the evolution of hockey in Las Vegas. And you go back dating to the Thunder was here previously. And then, you know, the outdoor game at MGM with Wayne Gretzky, that the ice is melting and the complete spectacle of that, to the Wranglers in the ECHL that I played for, and now the Golden Knights. And to be at the pinnacle of the NHL, you know, this isn't just an organization that's come into the league and found their way a little bit. They came in, knocked the door down, and now it is a premier destination for players, for fans. And you see it on display here. People are traveling in from all over. I saw the mascots earlier coming in the lobby. That's always exciting. So it's a nice celebration, Scott. I think you really hit on it here. We are really all hopeful that this will be a turning point for the NHL, especially after the All-Star game concludes with the change in the COVID testing and everything else.
Exactly.
Hopefully we get some hockey with a lot of players on the ice from here on until the end of playoffs.
The thing that always grabs my attention when you come here, especially like being up in Canada, when the team was given to Vegas, I think there was a lot of, is this Arizona Coyotes 2.0? Is it just going to be a rink filled with snowbirds and tourists? And that's kind of it. But when you come here, and if you've never been to Vegas before since the Knights came in, this town is crazy about their Golden Knights. Like, there's Golden Knights stuff in every shop, on blackjack tables, whatever you can draw up. This town really does love their hockey, and it's great that they get this event to kind of showcase it.
Yeah, and if you go off the strip, you really notice it especially, Scott. You see it on the cars, the bumper stickers, everything. It's all over.
Well, license plates.
Well, and this is a team that is taking care of business, and, you know, I hate to bring it all back to Atlanta, but, you know, what the failings in Atlanta is not providing a grassroots hockey system, not supporting the hockey for the local. And I were talking about it at the game the other night. There's a regular gig at all the games, and it's, you know, they prompt the crowd to cheer. Are you a local or are you a tourist? And it's the tourist.
Locals.
No, but, and I think that's so critical to what will happen here, because listen, they're not going to be a Stanley Cup finalist every year. They're not going to make the playoffs every year. There are going to be fallow times in this team's future. But I think what they've done here, and my old pal Darren Elliott from Atlanta days, former Canadian Olympian, one of the many things he does for the Golden Knights, he's in charge of grassroots hockey and building the youth program here. And that is so critical to long-term success everywhere, but certainly here in a non-traditional, I hate to even use that term now, but in this marketplace, I really think they've done a nice job right from day one in building up that local hockey community. And I think it's going to pay dividends for years and years here.
Yeah.
A lot of positivity here in Las Vegas. And then last night, there comes the dark gray cloud that is yet another controversy with the Chicago Blackhawks. This team is 24th in the NHL standings, but they lead the league in apology statements sent per 60 or something like that. But Rocky Wirtz yesterday had some comments that definitely have him in some hot water and have a lot of hockey fans disappointed. Let's take a listen to a snippet of what happened last night.
I'm going to answer the question. I think the report speaks for itself. The people that were involved are no longer here. We're not looking back at 2010. We're looking forward. And we're not going to talk about 2010.
I know,
and I'm not either. And we're not going to talk about what happened. We're moving forward. That is my answer. Now, what's your next question?
I can pick up to what we are doing today. And I think
That's none of your business. That's none of your business. What we're going to do today is our business. I don't think it's any of your business.
How is it not my business?
Because I don't think it's any of your business. You don't work for the company. If someone in the company asks that question, we'll answer it. And I think you should get on to the next subject. We're not going to talk about Kyle Beach. We're not going to talk about anything that happened. Now we're moving on. What more do I have to say? You want to keep asking the same question? You hear the same answer? Okay, ask the next question.
There is a lot of that is incredibly concerning. But before we get to our take on it, there was a statement released last night that we can flash up right now. A statement from Chicago Blackhawks Chairman Rocky Wirtz. Tonight at the Chicago Blackhawks Town Hall, my response to two questions crossed the line. I want to apologize to the fans and those reporters, and I regret that my response overshadowed the great work this organization is doing to move forward. We have the right leaders and right processes in place to create a safe environment for our employees and players. And where I'll go with this, Mike, if you were a player in that organization or if you were an employee in that organization, what would you think reading that? Would you buy any of it?
Oh, it just looks so hollow. Mm-hmm. I mean, Rocky Wirtz just stood up there and berated journalists.
Mark Lazarus from The Athletic.
I mean, people who are vested in this in different ways. Like, it's not just media members that were there. It's a town hall setting. And to be so combative and to talk down to people and basically say, Kyle Beach situation is done. It's under the rug. It's never happened. It's exactly what happened when it occurred. And mm-hmm. How can you possibly say, okay, players, staff members, anybody, if you think that something's happening, you need to come to us, you need to do this. Like, how can you believe that? How can you believe that you're going to be heard when your owner doesn't want to even admit that this is still happening in a storyline? Because it is. Like, it's not going to go away. It was a very appropriate question. He said it's an inappropriate question. That's wrong. That's a very appropriate question because also the Blackhawks never stood up after the report was released and had anybody in front of the media. If you want to be transparent, you got to stand up and take the heat. And you got to be ready for these answers. It could have been the simplest answer.
Yeah.
There's so many things that could have been said that wasn't even combative that just simply indicated that as an organization, us as the Blackhawks will make sure that our players and our employees are safe, that they are able to come forward with anything that may be the case. And it would have been done. And instead, why is anybody going to give them their money?
Yeah.
If you're a fan, really, his son tried to talk him down. Danny was the CEO, and nothing came of that. It was basically dad saying, step down, son.
Yeah.
Terrible, Scott.
Well, it's hard to imagine this could have gone any worse for the Chicago Blackhawks. And it's a catastrophic event for a team that is trying to repair an image that has been sullied by maybe one of the worst scandals in NHL history.
Yeah.
And to have that kind of response puts a lie to everything that the team has said and done since the report came out. And I think the question now has to be, how can Rocky Wirtz remain in the position as the senior executive in the face of that franchise? And I can't imagine what the response must have been for the NHL leaders, Gary Bettman, Bill Daly, when they saw that happening, because the ramifications are enormous. And I'm wondering now how Rocky Wirtz continues in that position. The apology is ham-handed and just it does boggle the mind that it happened that way. And now it's once again front page news for the Chicago Blackhawks, as it should be. And their response to the scandal is, I think reveals, the many, many miles they have to go to get things right.
Let's move on here. And if something does develop throughout the day, we'll have more on it tomorrow on our show, obviously, and over at dailyfaceoff.com. We'll be covering it. Another story off the ice that is official as of, I believe, an hour ago. Pat Verbeek is the new general manager out in Anaheim. As you can see, the official release here, 35 years in the NHL. Pat Verbeek, really the definition of a hockey lifer. This is a guy who's done it all at a ton of different levels. Mike, what's the significance of this hiring happening
for the Ducks to do it at this time? Because they didn't want to go into summer with question marks, especially with the number of unrestricted free agents, RFAs that they have on the board. You've got players in Anaheim that need contracts. And are you going to move them? You've got Lindholm on the back end, Raquel. You've also got Josh Manson, who's a huge part of that team. And Pat Verbeek now has to take this into account. Where are we going to go with these players? Because to me, I look at someone like Lundestrom, I look at Lindholm, even Manson. Like, I would want to keep these players if you can pull that off. And I think that the significance to me is that really, Scott, this is Pat Verbeek coming in. And this matters to me and as a player. If I'm looking at, if I'm trying to believe in this organization going forward, that, hey, we've got a good start here. We've got a coach we believe in. We're playing well. We've got young talent. I'm not thrilled with their back end. You know, they can use a little depth up front. Verbeek can handle that.
Yeah.
But I think the weight of hiring Pat Verbeek, who spent 8 years working next to Steve Yzerman in Tampa Bay and then going to Detroit with him, winning Stanley Cups, it's a little bit different than hiring Jeff Solomon. All the respect in the world for Jeff Solomon, but Pat Verbeek carries some weight with his name.
Yeah, there's no question. I mean, what was his nickname? The little ball of hate as a player.
I liked him less than anybody in the NHL as a kid.
Yeah, well, with good reason. I think a lot of people felt the exact same way. But, you know, and having run into Pat over the years in press boxes and watching him work, and you alluded to it, Mike, having learned at the knee of Steve Yzerman, and of course we know that Julian Brisebois has carried on the torch in Tampa since Steve Yzerman left to go back to Detroit. It's hard to imagine a better education for Pat Verbeek, and now moving into his first GM role. I think it's an outstanding hire. And that Ducks team they're close. Yeah. And you know, again, you know, we talk about the tumultuous time for the Anaheim Ducks with Bob Murray being forced to step aside and go into a treatment facility. I think this is the perfect answer to that. I think this team's ready to rejoin whether it's Stanley Cup contender yet or not, but certainly playoff team. Terrific young talent there, but they do have a lot of questions to answer in terms of their contract. You know, the Lindholm Manson contracts loom large for that team. Yeah. But I just think Pat Verbeek is an incredible hire, and to get him into place before the March 21st trade deadline, you know, where the Ducks going to be buyers? What are they going to do with those assets if they don't feel that they can lock up either Lindholm or Manson long term? You know, do you try and move them while still staying in the playoff hunt? I mean, it's a lot of balls in the air for the Anaheim Ducks. I think getting Pat Verbeek into that role right now with some run where the trade deadline is critical. I like that team, and I think that's a great fit for the Ducks and their fans. They deserve this.
Yeah, and it is something that should get the fan base excited, because you look back at what he did, obviously, with Tampa Bay. Another fan base that is certainly excited right now, fans of the Minnesota Wild. This team, a big win on national TV last night, 6 in a row. They're 9-0-1 in their last 10. Scott, I'll start with you. Is this Wild group, as it's constructed right now, good enough to be a Stanley Cup contender in your eyes?
Yeah, I think so.
A little hesitation, Scott.
I'm not unequivocal that yes, they are a contender. Mm-hmm. Listen, they play like it. The numbers speak for themselves. Yes. Okay. Yes, they are a Stanley Cup contender, but I'm curious to see what Bill Guerin does between now and the trade deadline. This Wild team is in such a curious spot in terms of their evolution, because looked at Cap Friendly this morning, I think they have the projection of $11 million in cap space at the trade deadline, but they are also a team that in the next 2 or 3 years is going to have a ton of dead cap hits as a result of buying out both Ryan Suter and Zach Parise. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this is a window that is open for them. You know, the question for Bill Guerin, do you trade some of your assets? They've got a whole, you know, they've got all their picks really for the next 2 or 3 years. Do you trade some of those assets to bring in depth up front? They're one of the top scoring teams in the NHL, which I admit was a bit surprising. Mm-hmm. Do you make those kinds of moves knowing that you're really going to have to rely on your draft for the next 3 or 4 years, you know, to overcome the cap hits that came with that difficult decision to buy out those two veteran players? So they're right there. They're a ton of fun to watch. I don't know. What do you think, Mike?
Well, I think if the Minnesota Wild, especially if Bill Guerin looks at this and thinks we can make this team better, he's got cap room to play with. Yes, they do have all their picks, but they're close enough right now that this is really a window where you got to go for it.
Yeah.
I really believe that. I mean, if you're going to play it safe in this type of scenario, why are you playing hockey? And I think this team has talent that can lead them forward. They just gave Jordan Greenway a nice contract, but a lot of it has been through not just the scoring, but the play of their goaltending. Yeah. I mean, Kaapo Kähkönen, start of the year, I'm not sure that the Minnesota Wild were convinced that they had the goaltending to go on the run. Well, Kähkönen has answered. He has been on fire in the last 10 games, last month and a half. He's really grabbed hold. And then Cam Talbot comes back after being out and goes 3-0. So they're in a good place goaltending-wise. They're scoring. I like that team. If Bill Guerin can add pieces at a reasonable price, I think he should. This is a time to go for the Minnesota Wild because they all believe in Dean Evason.
Potential Jack Adams candidate.
I'm totally on board now with Mike's answer.
I'm sell jobs. Yeah. You know, I like that way that team's constructed. I watch them play, I think this is a team that contend. They play heavy, they play hard, and they're pretty deep.
Well, if I go back to our board, our awards board that we put up at the midpoint of the season. You know, Dean Evason was a finalist last year for Coach of the Year, losing out to Rod Brind'Amour, but he should be right in the mix again because this is a team that were they a playoff bubble team? Anyway, they're far exceeded that, and Dean Evason's done a great job there as head coach.
Yeah, absolutely. It'll be a great second half story to see what the Wild do leading up to the trade deadline. But before we get to the second half of the season, it's All-Star Weekend. So let's get a little deeper into All-Star Weekend, delivered by our friends at DoorDash. All right, Inside All-Star Weekend, going to be our big segment on today's show and tomorrow's show as well, since, obviously, we're live from Las Vegas for All-Star Weekend, delivered by DoorDash. We've scoured the rosters. We're giving our expert analysis on all of this. The most surprising All-Star to you on the list coming out here this weekend. Mike, your take.
Jordan Kyrou, the St. Louis Blues. Mm. And, you can look to some of the bottom feeder teams and find players that would be surprising because those teams aren't very good and you do have to send somebody. Mm-hmm. But Jordan Kyrou playing for the Blues, he's leading the team in scoring. And you think about that club and the star power that's there. You've got O'Reilly and Perron and Krug. That's a deep club, Tarasenko. Kyrou has taken the next step. He's leading that team in points, but also in the way that he drives play. You watch him skate. You watch him handle the puck, the confidence that he's playing with, the chemistry with Robert Thomas. Doug Armstrong's done a real nice job there. He's let the young players grow into the role in St. Louis. They've been surrounded by really strong veterans. They've got a good mix. Boy, that'd be a fun series, wouldn't it? Minnesota-St. Louis one another. Yeah. Wouldn't that be good? But yeah, I think Jordan Kyrou is my pick. He was a surprise. But he's done a great job so far this season.
Scott?
First of all, when you think about the All-Star weekend, sometimes there's a bit of cynicism. Some of the veteran players, maybe they don't want to come. And, I totally get that part of it. It was years ago the NHL introduced a punitive action if a player was selected to All-Star weekend. If they weren't injured, basically if you didn't have a doctor's note, you were suspended for the first game after. And, I think that rubbed people the wrong way. I totally understand why you had to do that because you want to maintain the integrity. Mm-hmm. I think we're going to have 20 first-time All-Stars weekend. And I love that part of it. But for me, I'd love to see a guy like Joe Pavelski getting a shot. I think this is his third All-Star appearance. But, Joe Pavelski is getting on in his career. He's in a contract year. So his contract is coming up with the Dallas Stars. What do the Stars do? Are they going to be buyers or sellers? Teams would line up to get Joe Pavelski in their lineup by the trade deadline. But I think of Joe Pavelski and his family, and this must be a real treat for him. Here I am speaking for Joe Pavelski, but I assume, the opportunity to come to Vegas with your family, maybe this is his last opportunity. I remember being at St. Louis at the last All-Star game, talking to Eric Staal. Very similar, right? Has his family there and his kids on the ice, and it's a real meaningful thing, I think, for a lot of players, whether it's first time or maybe it's an opportunity towards the end of your career to take part in something like this. So I'm really happy for Joe Pavelski and can't wait to see how it works out for Team Central Division.
Yeah, absolutely. For me, my biggest surprise is going to be Jake Guentzel. You think back to past All-Star games, always Crosby, Malkin, Letang, Fleury back in the day, right?
Usual like suspects.
How often are we coming to an All-Star weekend where one of those usual suspects aren't there? And for Jake Guentzel to be having the year that he's had, 23 goals, 23 assists, looks like he's primed to score 40 this year. For him to be doing that, but also been doing it when they don't have Sidney Crosby in the lineup for a lot of the games. They don't have Evgeny Malkin in the lineup for the first half of the season, or at least very much in the first half of the season. Gensel's been a great surprise and one of those guys who, if you had told me at the beginning of the year he was going to be an All-Star and he was going to score a lot of these goals without Crosby, I probably wouldn't have believed you. But I want to circle back to what you were talking about, Scott, in terms of what this means for players. And maybe this is a question for you as well, Mike, and you got to go to a couple American League All-Star games later on in your career. What does it mean when you finally get that call after kind of grinding away?
It can mean so much to to players in different ways. Like Scott alluded to, you think of Joe Pavelski, who can really celebrate this with his family. Mm-hmm. Yep. You know, it's an opportunity. I mean, if he chooses so, to bring your kids in. And but then you think of maybe like Jack Campbell.
What a great story.
You know, I mean, he's had to claw his way to being a starting goaltender in the National Hockey League. And if this being selected to an All-Star game is something of like an affirmation of your career and what you've accomplished. And then you get the young players who've just hit the big time, and it's such a jolt of energy to them, and they're so excited. Yeah. So it can mean different things to different players, but it is an honor. It's something that you will always have on your resume. It's always a feather in your cap. And even if it's your only one, even if you don't win a Stanley Cup, it's something you can hang your hat on and say, at one point in my life, I was one of the best. And here's the roster to prove it.
do you have your jersey from the All-Star event?
I do.
Yeah. Have you not seen his closet? He has every jersey ever.
I do. I see it every week. It's hard to tell.
I have the ECHL All-Star jersey. I have the American League All-Star jersey. And we all know I wasn't anywhere close to an NHL All-Star jersey. But yes, I do have those. Those things are really nice to us and letting us take one home.
Yeah, no, I agree with Mike. And I think it's, you know, for young players, you know, to get to come and rub shoulders with their peers and to be part of that. I think of a guy like Freddie Anderson, you know, having a terrific season in Carolina. You know, it didn't end all that well for him in Toronto. And so you wonder, you know, how is it going to work? How's it going to fit in a new home? Well, you know, the Carolina Hurricanes are one of the top teams in the NHL. Freddie Anderson has to be in the Vezina Trophy discussion at this point. For him to come here and to be part of this kind of event, you know, I'm sure that maybe some guys would prefer to be feet up for a week
headed
or
to the
4 or 5 days,
up.
Whatever. But no, I think it's a really important signal for a lot of players. And you wonder, coming out of All-Star, will there be players who, you know, have a boost of confidence from this? And you wonder what's the cumulative effect of being honored this way? And does it translate into success coming out of the All-Star break? I'm curious to see that.
Yeah, me too. And I think it's real. Yeah, you know,
I think it is.
I think you can walk out of this and have a little burst of energy. And there's just so many cool things going on. You know, a chance to interact with fans. They're going to be out shooting pucks on the Bellagio Lake.
I mean, unreal.
That's going to be unreal.
You know? So, yeah. I mean, this is Vegas, too. It's cool. Look at our screen right now. I mean, we got the neon and everything. Like, it's a neat event for me. And the players were excited to come to Vegas.
And I think that's a big part of it, too. And I think maybe this is something we could talk about tomorrow as well. But keeping it in spots where players want to go. I get that you want to give that incentive to every market and give that reward to every market. Mm-hmm. But to talk about it potentially going to Florida, right? Again, a spot where I think a lot of players would want to go. But we'll have more on that tomorrow. That's going to be a wrap for Inside All-Star Break, delivered by DoorDash. All right, let's move into our daily face-off inbox question. And this one comes from our friend Ryan Pike over at Flames Nation. And this is something, I mean, without the question, we were talking about this a little bit earlier as well. But who is the best target for the Calgary Flames coming up to the deadline? Mike?
I really like Claude Giroux. Mm-hmm. And a lot of this is going to be driven by Giroux himself. Chuck Fletcher, the general manager of the Philadelphia Flyers, has said, hey, Claude's going to have the opportunity to make the decision if he wants to move on or not. But I look at that Flames roster, and down the middle, I think they could use a little bit of help. Backlund mm-hmm. and Monahan, they've been fighting for second, third line minutes at center, and neither of them really grasp that role. And I just look at how Giroux could fit into that team. He could play first line if necessary, but I don't see that happening with the way Lindholm plays up front. I think mm-hmm. that really fits his second or third, a boost on the power play for them. And I think he'd fit right into Daryl Sutter. I think that once you show up and have the pressure taken off of you of being the captain previously, mm-hmm. sometimes that's a weight off your shoulders. You know, you just walk in and you can play your game. So I like Giroux there. I think the addition of the leadership quality and the experience, he'd really work in that locker room and give him a little boost in scoring. Not that they really need much of it. I mean, they're scoring left and right, but he would help.
Yeah, and the thing about Claude Giroux, of course, can play the wing. He's gone back mm-hmm. and forth. So natural, you know, the first part of his career played a lot of center and then has more moved to the wing. But you're right. What kind of options for Daryl Sutter? You know, for me, though, the circle back, maybe the former captain, Mark Giordano, in a contract year in Seattle, hasn't gone the way I think a lot of us expected it would go for the Kraken. Not sure how he fits in long-term for Seattle in terms of dollar term moving. He gets a little bit closer to the end of what is an extraordinary career for him. And what does he know best? He knows the Calgary Flames. He knows that marketplace. And having talked to Mark in the past, it's just such a quality person. Come playoff time, come the grind. Listen, the Flames team's not guaranteed a playoff spot. That West is, it's the Wild West. It's wide open. The Oilers in the mix there. We talked about the Ducks. I like Mark Giordano as a fit because it's just a seamless kind of thing. Question is, you know, what Ron Francis going to want in terms of return. But I like Mark Giordano going back to Calgary.
Interesting. Yeah, the idea. I mean, a lot of talk about that team adding scoring depth and adding a forward, but scoring at times really hasn't been much of an issue. So maybe they do pivot and go with a defenseman. Speaking of teams that can maybe go on a run, that ties in nicely to our daily bet segment delivered by PointsBet. There's no games for me to bet on tonight.
You're in Vegas.
I'm in Vegas.
I have some options here.
There are other sports in the world.
But it's a good enough time at the halfway point to take a look at what the Stanley Cup odds are, courtesy of our friends at PointsBet. And really not surprising at all that it's the Colorado Avalanche sitting at the top, plus 450 to win the Stanley Cup. The top five includes the Panthers, Golden Knights, Lightning, and the Carolina Hurricanes, who've seen a big jump up. The last time we did this, kind of about a month and a half ago, it was the Canes down at that 12-1 range. The Toronto Maple Leafs there, 6th, 9-1. Listen, they're always a little bit overvalued, but that's what public money can do in the betting space. But as we scroll our way down here, you can see Boston, Pittsburgh, and the Minnesota Wild at 15-1. And that's an interesting spot for me. And if you're looking to maybe sprinkle a little bit of money on a team right now to win the Stanley Cup, I would look at teams like Minnesota and New York that you know will have wiggle room and assets at the deadline and that could potentially load up a little bit before a playoff run. But as you can see, the rest of the playoff teams kind of just slot in after that. The Calgary Flames, we talked about, the Blues, the Predators, the Capitals at 25-1. If they get a goalie, that's a team that I wonder about if they can just get hot at the right moment. And then you can see Edmonton 35-1, potentially the same spot there with the Oilers. But I mean, neither of you guys are necessarily big hockey bettors, but when you look at that list, is there a team that you maybe think it catches your eye and you go, hey, they might be a little undervalued here?
Well, I know everyone loves Colorado and why not? I was talking to a scout last week or so, and what, of course, a lot of us are waiting for the arrival. Jack Eichel's here in Vegas, but his arrival in that lineup could happen as soon as, you know, a week or so after the All-Star break. He seems just about ready to get into it. And I talked to the scout who felt that center depth position for Vegas with Eichel in the lineup, he likes them ahead of Colorado. Now, you know, listen, Colorado's absolutely on fire. It'd be interesting to see what Joe Sakic does approaching the trade deadline. But remember last year in the playoffs, that Vegas team really smothered the Avs. The Avs had no answer for what Vegas brought. And with Eichel in that lineup, Pete DeBoer's options in terms of dialing around the centers and the forward depth, I like Vegas. I know they're up near the top, but I think Vegas might be, they were a team that I had going a long way at the beginning of the season. I have no reason to think any differently right now.
Tyler, I'll give you a couple quick ones there. Carolina for your safe bet.
Yeah.
But if you're looking for your long shots, I really like Pittsburgh and Minnesota at the odds that are given right there.
Yeah, some really juicy payouts right now if you're looking to get into the futures markets. That's our betting report brought to you by PointsBet. And as we always do, we will wrap up the show with a little garbage time. And Mr. Burnside, you drew the straw. It's your turn.
I drew the straw. And when the Edmonton Oilers signed Evander Kane, I didn't like it. I didn't like the motivation, which was win at all costs, right? So anyway. It is what it is.
We're desperate. We'll take anyone. We don't care what the legal proceedings are.
That's it. But I will say this, and Mike and I were talking about this. Evander Kane's 2 goals, 1 assist in his 3 games with the Oilers. Nice job. I think they're 5-0-1 in their last 6.
Yeah, they're on a bit of a roll.
On a bit of a roll. Have now, you know, they're right back in the playoff hunt. And I wonder if Evander Kane's arrival there, from the outside at least, has taken some of the pressure off Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl. I mean, we spent a lot of time talking about the very public testiness between the media and, I think, by extension, the fan base and the Edmonton Oilers during their swoon. I wonder if just Evander Kane's presence has focused the attention away from those two leaders just enough to allow a little breathing space. The questions are different now, and the team's winning, of course, so that changes things. But I wonder if it's not just what Evander Kane's doing on the ice, which is has been great, and it provides Dave Tippett all kinds of options in terms of his, you know, rolling out three or four lines that, you know, can be effective and are hard to defend. But I wonder if just that little bit of breathing space for Dreisaitl and McDavid has allowed them to get back into the groove that we saw them in at the start of the season. So there you go. There's Evander Kane paying dividends already. Who knew?
He's the distraction they needed.
He's the distraction they needed. Well put.
Absolutely. Speaking of distractions, I'm going to try just, you know, keep working throughout the day here, not get too distracted by the bright lights and the fancy blackjack tables down here in Vegas. But we'll be back tomorrow. As always, keep it locked on dailyfaceoff.com. Skills comp tomorrow as well, which should be a ton of fun. For Mike McKenna and Scott Burnside, I'm Tyler Remchuk. Thanks for tuning in. We'll chat again tomorrow afternoon.
Thanks for watching the Daily Faceoff Show.
Make sure you hit subscribe on our YouTube channel to never miss an episode.